So my name is Jenna Rollins, and if you haven't attended any of our Zoom presentations that we've done this semester, I'm an assistant director in career development services, and I'm going to be talking about LinkedIn today. So not only creating your profile, but how to make your profile even better and how to use it to start networking. So I am going at the end of the presentation, myself or Samantha will be emailing you with the PowerPoint as well as some handouts on LinkedIn, and we will be sharing the recording so you can go back and to listen to anything if you missed it as well. Samantha will be manning the chat, so if you have any questions, you can type in the type them into the chat. Samantha or myself will answer it throughout the presentation. But other than that, we'll get started. Oops. All right. So what today you will learn to understand how to maximize your individual LinkedIn profile sections and the content, and then how to interpret the job search and alumni search features on LinkedIn, which are really helpful. Okay. So if you don't have a LinkedIn, why do we recommend students to use LinkedIn? We do this because there's 467 plus million users all across the world, and about 400 million students and recent college graduates are actively using LinkedIn. So about 40% of those users log into LinkedIn daily, and then 57% of companies have a LinkedIn company profile page. So if there's a particular company that you're really interested in, definitely make sure to see if they have a LinkedIn page. And this is where you can get information on the company as well as networking with people that work for that company within their page. And then through a recent study, it shows that 70% of hiring professionals are using social media in their search process. And then of that 77%, 94% of them were using LinkedIn. So LinkedIn is a great place for not only networking, but also for job searching. So this is why we recommend for students to use it, because it's all, you know, still today, even with technology, job searching is still about who you know, and you can meet a lot more people through LinkedIn. All right, so the first part. So once you decide that you wanna have a LinkedIn and you go to create your profile, the biggest thing is you wanna make sure you include a picture. A lot of times people will not connect with someone if they do not have a picture, because to them it might be, is this an actual person? Is this a bot? You know, they wanna make sure that they're actually connecting with someone real. And a picture makes that more visible. And also with that is you're 14 times more likely to have your profile viewed if there is a photo. So employers pay to use, there's an employer portion of LinkedIn. And when these employers pay, they can search for potential candidates. So not only can you search and apply for a job, but an employer can actually search for people on their own. And with this, if you have a picture, you're more likely to have an employer check out your profile. And like it says in the presentation, it doesn't have to be super fancy. You don't have to go and pay money to have this super professional LinkedIn headshot. You can do a professional LinkedIn headshot at home. And on the next couple slides, I have some ways to do that. But it doesn't, you don't have to overthink it. Just a professional photo, you know, simple shirt, blouse, polo, you know, something to where it's not too distracting for the person looking at it. And then a headline. So like David's says, econ major and aspiring financial analyst. So you want to tell people what you're excited about now or what your plans are for the future. So this is a way for someone to quickly, just by glancing at your photo and your name, to figure out what you're all about. So some ways to take your profile picture at home. So you want to polish yourself. You know, I know we've all been in our sweatpants every day. I know I normally am, but this is a time to put on something that's more professional for the shot. You want to make sure that you find a location and the right lighting. So, you know, a blank wall. So if you can kind of see the wall behind me, you know, just simple, plain. You don't need anything fancy. to create your shot. Now, to double check your light, this is where you're going to have to take a couple practice shots to see, based off the picture, if the lighting's right. And then if it's not, I always say, you know, see if you can find a lamp from another room. If the lighting isn't good, bring it in just for that, you know, just for the pictures. And then the best way is, if you don't have someone to take the photo for you, use the timer on your phone or on your laptop to help set up to take the picture for yourself. And, you know, sometimes, you know, the height might not be right. You can use textbooks, you know. You might have to get a little creative to how to get your phone or your laptop at the correct level that you're looking for. So it might take a couple tries. Now, if you have someone to take a photo, definitely use them. And I'd always say, try different poses to see which one you like best. And, you know, try some different top options. So the most of your photo will be from about your shoulders up. LinkedIn has changed the types of how big the photos are a couple times, but for the most part, it's normally, you know, your shoulders up. So the majority of it is just going to be your face. And then once you take the photo, file or edit, export, and then upload it into LinkedIn. And some do's and don'ts: definitely make sure it's a plain background. Kind of think about it, if you were going to do a Skype interview, you know, you don't want anything distracting in that interview. Same with the picture. You want them looking at the content. And then we always recommend 500 by 500 pixel images if you can. And then again, like I said, crop it, because about 80% of the frame is just going to be your face. And still wear a professional top, because whatever, you know, whatever they are going to see, you want to make sure it's professional. And you want to avoid selfies, because it doesn't look as professional, or photos where you've cropped someone out. It's still going to look like you cropped someone out, or you don't want, you know, your photo of your face and then you kind of see half of someone else's shoulder. So just a simple photo that you can do at home. Now, sorry. All right. So now you've uploaded your picture, you have your headline. So now you're going to go to your profile summary. So once someone clicks on your profile, you know, after your heading information, this will be the next section that they see. So we recommend trying to keep it short and sweet and to the point, because just like a resume, an employer doesn't want to be reading a long novel. So we recommend trying to keep it to about 40 words or more, so that you're more likely to turn up in an employer search. So employers can search by keywords that they're looking for. So within this summary, you want to describe what motivates you, what you're skilled at, what's next. So, you know, what are you pursuing career-wise? So if you're pursuing to be a financial analyst, like David was in the previous slide, you know, describe this. What are your skills? You know, what types of positions are you looking for, so that the employer gets a better idea of you as a whole. Okay. And then you're going to go into your experience section. So I always recommend that before you update your LinkedIn experience section, make sure that you've updated your resume first, because you don't want to update one and then have to go back and update another and then have to go back and update your LinkedIn again. So I always recommend update your resume first and then go on to your LinkedIn, so that you don't have to keep going back and forth. So you want to list what positions you've held, even if it's part-time, along with what you've accomplished, especially if there was any, if you saved the company any money, if you were employee or intern of the month, if there was any big projects that you did, make sure you include those accomplishments in there, because that's what employers want to see. And especially if you did a presentation or there's evidence of that project, you can upload that information under that experience. You can include links, you can include photos from it, as well as if there was if you written any articles or if PowerPoint. So you can include all of that data so that the employer can actually see what you've done. If you're a graphic artist, you can include, you know, samples of your work. That way the employer can see it already. All right. So onto your education section. So you definitely want to make sure that ODU is on there. I know a lot of times we'll meet with students who don't have ODU on their resume because they think that they can't put it on there until they've received their degree. So you can. You're not going to put that you graduated yet, though. So you want to make sure that you list ODU on there so that the employer does know that you are attending ODU. And this is a great way when you list your education on there to kind of find people to network with. Because a lot of times when you start looking at companies, it'll show how many people have attended the same schools as you. So it's a great way to find people to network with and break that ice because, you know, you can talk about ODU, how was their experience there. So you definitely want to make sure you list your education on there. If you, same with your resume, we do recommend that you try to stick with places that you've received a degree or are attending currently. So if you received your associates, definitely list that on there too, because that's also another great way to break the ice with someone. You can include, you can include courses on here under your education. If you did any study abroad or study away experiences, that's also a great thing. You can include projects as well. So organizations. So if you can list any clubs or organizations that you've done at ODU or out in the community, because this also lets the employer know about yourself. Like, what are you interested in? What do you value? And you can also, when you add this information on the organization, it's also another way for you to connect with someone as well, because it'll show if they've been in that organization as well. These are all great things, not only for the employer to see, but for you to find out about other people so that you have a shared connection. So it's a lot easier to network with them. And if you have any questions, please type it into the chat. If you see my eyes darting, I keep trying to check the chat to see if anyone's put anything in there.
We do have one question.
Okay.
What does forward of left towards the content mean in terms of taking a photo?
Oh, that way, so you're not exactly looking like directly into the camera, but just a little off. So, you know, just squaring your shoulders. So it might look on your side that I'm looking right, but I'm looking to the left on my computer, but just a little, so it's not directly straight ahead, if that makes sense. Plus, when you square your shoulders, it's just a more professional shot. Normally, kind of think about when you did all of your photos in elementary and middle school, where they always have you sit in that chair and then they have you kind of squared a little bit to the camera, that type of position. Hopefully that helps. If not, just message me in the chat. Okay, so we've done our education, our experience. Now we're going to go on to our skills and endorsements. So one of the great things about LinkedIn is that you can add your skills. These can be soft skills and they can be hard skills, that computer skills, language skills. These are all your skills that you have that are marketable for an employer. You can search them. You can, and if even if they don't have it specifically listed, you can type it in and save it as a skill. And one of the other things is, as you can see in the presentation, they have like little pictures by it. So it's people that have endorsed you. So if economics, and people that you've worked with know that you really are great with economics, people can endorse you in that. So basically they're saying, yes, this person is really great in that skill. So we will recommend at least 5 skills. And that's because another thing is employers can search by your skill. So you want to make sure that you're listing your top skills, especially the skills that are relevant for the career field that you are pursuing. You can definitely list way more than 5. This way, you know, you've listed all of the skills that are relevant to what you're applying for. Now, not everyone is going to endorse you. It depends on how much people use LinkedIn, but I'd still say is still list your skills so that way an employer does see them. Right. Another thing that if you can do, I would definitely recommend doing it, is you can get recommendations. So unlike a resume where you just have your list of references, on your LinkedIn profile, you can have people that are writing testimonials about you and saying, you know, great employee, great coworker, you know, whatever it is, they're basically testifying to the type of professional person that you are. Just like with your references, I recommend your managers, current or former, professors, classmates. If you've been in a student or community organization, someone that you work with in there, someone that can talk about you professionally is a great person to get. And like it says in the presentation, it gives you credibility to your strength and skills. So in, just like how someone can endorse you, you can actually get someone to write a quick testimonial about you and how you do have those skills. Okay, so you've done your recommendations. So now you're gonna start applying for positions. So this kind of breaks down how it goes when you're looking for positions. So you're gonna apply for the position. The search committee is gonna review your application. And then they're going to kind of narrow it down. And from there, a lot of times, this is where search committees check your LinkedIn and your social media. So a lot of search committees do this to kind of get a better idea of who you are, not just on your resume. So this is why we always say check your social media for professionalism, because people are going to probably search for you. They're going to search for you on LinkedIn, and you can also do the same. So if you've been called for an interview and they give you who you're interviewing, search for them on LinkedIn, because this can also give you some things to break the ice at the interview. Also, if you don't know what they look like, you have an idea already of who they are. So when you go in, you can already have your hand out ready to shake their hand because you know who the person is, instead of, you know, not sure if they're coming for you or if they're coming for someone else. So it goes both ways. So this is where they can, the employer can start getting more information about you. This is why we do recommend adding artifacts to your LinkedIn. So they can already be checking out these artifacts about your work, as well as your skills. They can look at your recommendations. And for them too, they have a picture of who you are. So they can already know when you go in for the interview, which one. And mutual connections, because that can always, you know, start a conversation that, oh, you know, so-and-so. So, you know, something, just anything to make you and them a little bit more comfortable in the interview. Because just remember, while you're nervous as the interviewee, don't forget, you know, most of the time is you're not the only one that's nervous. It could be someone's first time of leading an interview, or they're nervous too because they want to make sure that they find a great candidate. So they're nervous about the whole interview process because they're unsure if they're going to find what their company is looking for. So it's not just you that is the only one that's nervous in the process. All right. So accomplishments that you can also include on your profile, honors and awards. This is where you can definitely include anything that you've received within your student organization or within your department. Anything that you've just received from ODU as a whole, this is where you want to not be shy. You want to put these on there. And then you can include your courses, projects as well. So say you don't have a ton of experience in your field. Projects are still very relevant. Just like we say on your resume, put projects on there. Same with your LinkedIn. And it just like I talked about with your experiences, if you can include some artifacts from your projects, that's great as well. And like it kind of shows on the presentation, you can include and tag who were a part of your project if they have a LinkedIn as well. Okay, so LinkedIn groups. So your profile is 5 times more likely to be viewed if you join or are active in a group. So some great groups to join is, you know, your university groups. So ODU has groups. Sometimes different departments will have them, as well as any professional associations that you're involved in, or groups for people that want to pursue a particular career. I always recommend whatever you're interested in, start searching to see if there's any groups of around that you could join. So this way you can start join discussions about your career field and with other people that work in the field. So it's a way for you to start networking. And once you start, you know, joining these conversations, it can lead to connections between other people and potential colleagues in the future, or just anyone, you know, you can just make another nice connection, and you never know where that connection could lead. So what I'm sure a lot of you are probably interested in is job and internship searching. So LinkedIn is also a great place to look for positions. Depending on the employer, you can apply straight through LinkedIn for a position, or some will have the apply button, but the apply button will take you to their company website. Either way, it's still great to use LinkedIn as a job search tool, because depending on what the company is or who the company is, they might post about this position on LinkedIn first before they post on any other website. So it's always great to check it. And this also allows you to adjust your career interests so that you can see, so the employer can see whether you're interested in a search or just potential opportunities. So not only for you searching, but if you do this, it allows an employer to contact you. So it's in your privacy settings. You can click, you know, are you in a search? You can put your status. So, you know, currently searching, open to opportunities, you know, whatever it is. And it'll allow you to click on like what type of job titles, what locations you're interested in. So if employers are looking for potential candidates, you will pop up depending on their search and depending on where they're located as well. So that way, you know, if you're not interested in moving to Minnesota and you don't list it as one of the locations, you most likely won't be contacted from someone there. All right. So continuing with this, you can also click what types of positions you're open for. So full-time contract, internship, as well as the industries as well. And it, depending on maybe you want to only work with a small company, you can put, you know, the type of the size of company that you're interested in working with. So this really helps you narrow it down so that, you know, your time isn't being wasted by getting contacted from employers that really, you know, you're not interested in. And same with the employers, they're not wasting their time too. So now on the internship job page, so this is a kind of a snapshot of what it looks like. You can search for positions. You can search for the type of industry, the location. Definitely, if you don't put a location state, you're going to get a lot of jobs. So I always recommend trying to start smaller before you go to the broader whole nation, because if you put the United States, it's going to give you a lot, kind of just like Indeed and Monster. It's a lot to go through. So I would do like particular region if you can, but if you're open to like the whole state of Virginia, you can put Virginia. It's definitely going to still be a lot, but definitely not as many if you put the United States. You can also do by date posted. So maybe you only want jobs that were just posted within like the last week or two. The experience level, you can put, you know, whatever experience level you're looking for as well. So on, it'll, you know, have a little scroll with all of the positions, and then you can kind of look at another position. And what I always recommend is save them. If there's any that you're interested in and maybe you want to go back and do some more research on, save it so that you can keep scrolling through all of the options, and then you can go back and spend some more time looking at the jobs in more detail. All right. So continuing with the job and internship search, there is an alumni tool that allows you to search for graduates in particular types of jobs. So this is also a way for you to connect with people that work for a company that you're potentially interested in, or an industry, to kind of talk with them about, you know, how do they get their foot in the door? What do they, you know, what do they do on a daily basis? What do you recommend, or what do they recommend for new people getting into this career field? It's a great way to find connections and potentially where like a lot of alumni work. So this one is, I think this is what school. Well, I think it's a school in California. So it's kind of going over where do most people from this school currently live? You know, which area? So it says the United States, but then it goes into the particular areas. Then where do most of these people work? So you can kind of get an idea of, so where do a lot of people who have graduated from ODU work? You know, where do they live as well? All right. So then it goes like, what did they study? What are they skilled at? And then how are you connected? So you can kind of see of, you know, how do you have connections with these people? Is it through just your education? Maybe you've got some more people that you both are connected, you have mutual connections, or you're both involved in different organizations. It allows you to kind of see how are you connected with these people. All right. So one of the things before I go into the next section is, so you definitely want to, before you go and try and make a connection, unless you know them personally, you want to send them a message. So when you press connect on the computer version, it will say, do you want to include a message? I know all of my colleagues do too, always recommend that you send them a message. You are more likely going to get a connection with someone if you take the time to write a message to them. Even if you've met them at a conference, you're just more likely to get someone to connect than if you just pressed connect, but without any information. Especially if they don't know who you are, they're gonna go, why is this person connecting with them? If you send a personalized message, you know, this is where your mutual connections, you can, you know, talk about that or ODU, you know, some ask them a question, you know, how did you get your start? I see that you work with so-and-so company. I'm currently an ODU student pursuing, you know, a finance degree. What do you recommend for someone in this career field? You know, asking them a question, you're more likely going to get a connection and start a conversation with someone. Just be aware, if you do use the app, if you press connect, it does not give you the option to write a message first. It is just going to connect with someone right away. So I always recommend, if you are going to connect with someone that you don't know, use the computer version, so that way you can write a little note first. But if you're at a conference, a networking event, you can just connect with them and say, hey, I connected with you on the LinkedIn version. Sorry, I didn't write a note since the app doesn't, you know, allow me. People will understand, because that way you can do it right there and then. All right. So now that you've, you know, created your profile, dive right in and get started using LinkedIn for networking. So once you've created your profile, if you would like one of us to check it out, I would recommend you do it by college. So Casey is business, Alice is arts and letters, Ivy is engineering, myself, I'm education, and Summer is sciences and health sciences. So as long as your profile is public, you can include the link for us and then we can check it out for you. If there's a particular section that you want us to check out, or if you just say, you know, please look at my LinkedIn as a whole, we can definitely provide you feedback on that. You know, or if you're like, hey, I'm unsure of, you know, should I add anything else? You know, that's what we're here for. Just make sure that before you send us the link, that in your settings that you clicked public, otherwise we can't view anything as well. But I'll leave this up here for a couple more seconds. This includes our email addresses as well. Or if you visit our homepage, you can set up an appointment with us. If you wanna have us look at your LinkedIn over Zoom, we can do that. You know, you share your screen and then we'll go with, over your LinkedIn account with you right there and then. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask us, you know, whenever they come up. And just remember that you can continue to use our services free for life. So even if you are graduating this semester, you can continue to have us help you with your LinkedIn, resume, mock interviews, you know, whatever it is. All of our services are free for life, so you can continue to use us. But have a great rest of your day and stay safe. Thank you for attending.